Welcome you all for this program on the scientific heritage and culture. As you are aware, the planetarium, apart from its popularization and science education activities, is actively involved in the history of science aspects also. So when Gandhi Center Professor Nazareth approached us for this kind of a program, we thought that it would fit in to our goals here, and therefore we already agreed for that.
Professor R.N. Iyengar, a civil engineer, was at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore for almost four decades. From 1994 to 2000, he was director of the Central Building Research Institute in Roorkee. He's currently director, Center for Disaster Mitigation at Jain University, Bangalore, and editor of Sadhana, published by the Indian Academy of Sciences. He has held visiting professorships at Purdue University and Brooklyn Polytechnic and the Florida Atlantic University.
Now, I was introduced as being the director of the Center for Disaster Mitigation at Jain University. Well, true, I started after my retirement to establish a fire research lab there in 2005. And after about 8 years, I gave up that to others, my juniors and youngsters, which is running quite well. I shifted to my original interest, an interest which has been there with me for a very long time. That is to look into the history of science in India. The history is going to be, well, it has already been said by so many people, I will not repeat it, is something so close to our culture, so close to some of the things which have been talked about both by the on the left, by the right, and by the center. The whole country, in some way or other, looks at its culture to the skies. So it's an astral culture, one may say that. So this has intrigued me for quite some time, and I have been spending time on this subject for the last 6 to 7 years, and I'm going to present one little bit of this in this talk. The title of my talk is Heritage of Dhruva the Pole Star. Dhruva, of course, rings a bell to all of you, and Pole Star also rings a bell, no doubt. But how these two are connected with our culture is what I am going to talk, based on whatever evidences are available, and as an insider, as we are all insiders to the Indian culture and to Indian science, we can look at it from a way which is slightly different from the Western approach. I will come to the Western approach also towards the end. Now, the development of astronomy, already Professor Narasimha has covered, he has started with Aryabhata. That is the traditional starting of Siddhantic astronomy, even though it may go a little bit earlier to him, because the fundamental should have been already there, like the Soma Siddhanta and the other Siddhantas, the Pancha Siddhantika. So we can roughly say the Siddhantic period of Indian astronomy starts from the Common Era. But this should have had some background for it. Now, what is that background? That is, before the Common Era, what was the kind of astronomical thoughts or the scientific thoughts which were there? This is the question that we are addressing at the Jain University in the Center for History and Culture. Obviously, they would have known our ancients, including the Harappans, not just the Vedic people. I don't know the difference between the Harappans and the Vedic people, so I have put a comma there. And also about others who inhabited this country, the Gonds, the Bills, the Nagas, and the tribal people. They all would have looked at the sun, the moon, the stars, the same stars perhaps, the comets, the meteorites. They would have formed their own way of astronomical thinking. In fact, in TAFR, Professor Wahia works on the astronomy of the Gond tribes. He has written a few papers also, how they looked at Kritika and what was the name for Kritika in those days, so on and so forth. This may be called a cultural astronomy, not the mathematical astronomy or the Siddhanta astronomy of the later period, but this cultural astronomy would have been the foundation for whatever was done at a later period, which of course the proof for that, evidence for that can easily be seen in the Siddhantic texts which are available to all of us to study and understand. But the information available is in a highly dispersed, that is in various texts, in various forums, in allegorical fashion. And since it is too old, many of these are considered sacred, and so religious qualities have been attributed, and much of the religious practices or the cultural practices can be traced originally to some kind of astronomical concept. Obviously, even the common people, it is not just the Brahmins of Playfair who would have been working on this, even though they have preserved that knowledge. I will come to that. It's the Vedic text and the Sanskrit text, this knowledge even for the ancient period is preserved quite well for us to understand today. Even though the meaning of that as interpreted might vary from person to person, the interpretation, but we can as scientists understand these things quite clearly. Even the farmers would have been interested, because in the sowing, the harvesting, the rainfall, these are all connected with only some kind of an astronomical concepts only. So this is a precious heritage for us to preserve and celebrate. Now in this talk I will be considering the legend of Dhruva the pole star. Now this is a widespread cradle story in this country. I need not repeat it. And hence, it has been taken for granted. And neither the historians, nor the historians of astronomy, nor the Indologists have given too much importance to this legend at all, to the legend of the pole star. And it becomes quite intriguing as you enter into the BCE period more and more. And for the Siddhantic period, of course, they borrowed the concept of Dhruva as a Dhruvaka. That is one of the coordinates with which they measure from the pole. They wanted the same vocabulary. After all, as Professor Narasimha showed, the buzzwords which were there, these buzzwords have all evolved from only from previous vocabulary. And these vocabulary had their own meanings, and the meanings might have changed in Sanskrit. In fact, Sanskrit is notorious for that. And Panini says the Vyakaranas have no business to find the meaning. They only do the Shabda. They create the Shabda and give it. For meaning, it is only Rudi which has to be taken. It is the Loka which you have to understand, the Loka Pratiti. But meaning you should not do from Vyakarana is what he says. But anyway, that is another story. So, this has been taken or ignored as a mythological story. But the twists and turns that have occurred in this story, if you go through the Vedic texts, the epics, the Puranic texts of even the historical period over the millennia, they hide a scientific truth. That scientific truth is the inviolability of the phenomenon of precession of the Earth's rotational axis. This is the truth which is hidden, and much of the reason for differences in our culture, and also some amount of astronomical difficulties which in the Siddhantic astronomy period you see, Ayanamsha for that example, and the controversy with Ayanamsha and trepidation or rotation, they can all be traced to this. And that story is available for us even in the Vedic texts. Now the legend of Dhruva is well known, but let me just recollect, you know that he was the son of King Uttanapada. And he had to go because of his stepmother didn't like him sitting on the lap of his father. So he had to go and do a penance. And finally he got the boon from Vishnu. And the boon was, Vishnu said that you become Dhruva, you become the fixed pole star at the highest position I am going to give you. And you will be near me, that is with Vishnu. And not only that, because you are sent by your mother will also stay near you as a star for eternity. So this comes up in the Vishnu Purana in a very colorful way. And the colorful story, the origin of this colorful story in Vishnu Purana is due to the Brahmanda Purana. Brahmanda Purana doesn't say any of this. It only says it was a boon given by Brahma. And who is Brahma? It may be the same Brahma what Aryabhata and others were talking about. But if you see slowly, the same story comes up in all the later texts, particularly of the Bhakti tradition. because Dhruva is the fundamental for the Bhakti tradition, even in the Bhagavata, in various ways. But you wonder, is this pole star the pole star we see today? That is Polaris, or what is called Alpha Ursa Minor? Cannot be, because we know that from modern astronomy, the present pole star came to its position only in 1600 AD. And our Puranas, nobody has said that they are as recent as 1600 AD. The Brahmanda Purana, the Vishnu Purana, even the other Puranas, many of them are even dated to BCE, 500 BC, 300 BC, or Gupta period, 300 AD kind of thing. And Brahmanda Purana is considered, along with Vayu Purana, one of the oldest, and lot of linguistic work has been done on these two Puranas, comparison and all that. They have been normally dated, much of it, to the common era, linguistically. But the information contained in them may go back even to the first millennium BC or even older. We do not know that. In fact, that is the question which intrigued me. And they were written, of course, in the written form around this period. But why did the Puranas describe Dhruva as fixed? Because Dhruva, the meaning itself is fixed. The word Dhruva is used in various other contexts also, but everywhere more or less as decided, certain, fixed, or what you say, nishchita or so. In that sense only it is used. Confirmation, in that sense only it is used. So, earlier to Brahmanda Purana, the Yajurvedic text and the Mahabharata also refer to Dhruva. Mahabharata has a reference to Dhruva. And in fact, if you see the Bharati Vidya Bhavan series on the cultural heritage, also there has been a original 7-volume publication. In that, there is one paper on Mahabharata, and there is one statement. It says that in the Mahabharata, in the Bhishma Parva, trying to date the Mahabharata, they say that the pole star is moving. This is not possible. Pole star should be fixed. So this has to be something which is meaningless. They have ignored and gone further in that paper by a very great Sanskrit scholar, because they did not know the astronomical implication of that, you know. Now, is it possible the Sanskrit text starting from the Vedic period to the first millennium CE and to our times mentioned two different pole stars? This would be the question that you had to ask. Present day pole star is only from 1600. Or maybe approximately of that time. But why these people 1500 years ago, they were talking of Dhruva? And if you see some of the Siddhantic texts, I will have no time for that. They say, some people say there is a star in the Dhruva position. Some people say there is no star kind of thing. Why all this confusion arose for them? Before we discuss this text, let us see what astronomy has to do this. A star that is located at the north celestial pole looks fixed in the night for an observer in the northern hemisphere, well known. However, due to precession, this apparent fixity will slowly change. Initially, the star would be seen rotating in the night, that is, if you do a diurnal observation, evening to morning, that it is slightly rotating in that with reference to the others. But after a few centuries, it would have drifted away, quite a bit away from that place. That is over a period of several centuries. It is self-explanatory actually. You see, this is the Earth here, and the intersection with the ecliptic, and due to the rotation of the Earth, this is the north axis. Well, of course, coming to planetarium, you can have a better presentation, you know, when you go to the planetarium next time, you know. So, this gives a circle at the top. Any person who is looking at the north will be seeing something here. And then when take it down, you would see that along this circle, this is the present-day pole star. And along this circle, that is the polar circle, you come here, there is one star here, and then it stops at the current position. So what we have to be looking for is, in this period, so this is that circle which I am showing here, and we are here 2000 AD, we have to see here, there is another pole star here, around 3000 BC, roughly about plus or minus 100, 200 years. We will come to that question. And this is our cultural period in which we have to be interested. Because the text, I will show the evidences, talk of present day pulsar is very clear, even the Siddhantic texts talk about it. And the Vedic texts, the Puranic texts and the epics talk about this pole star. Now, this ancient pole star could have drifted to some other position and then it was no more the pole star. And hence, the question that we have to ask is, where has it been said as the pole star? Did they observe the movement of this pole star in the later thing? Did they attribute any reason to that, or were they afraid of it? Was there any religious functions organized about it? How was this information transmitted? Eventually to the Puranas and eventually as a legend of the Dhruva story. Now the earliest text which talks about the Dhruva is a Vedic text called the Taittiriya Aranyakam, which is available in print with all the discussions and all that. It talks that the rishis are with the stars, the saptarshis, that is the meaning of this, saptar triyo ascha, sarva triyo agastyascha, nakshatra shankrita avasan. Not only the seven rishis, but the agastyas also are with the stars. So agastya is the star canopus. So this is a Vedic information that is available in this text, that the stars were the originally the rishis. And also, Professor Narasimha mentioned about Anumana, and this text says, Smritihi Pratyaksham Aitihyam Anumanas Chatushtayam Yetaihi Aditya Mandalam Sarvairava Vidasyate. Everybody can understand sun by four things: Smriti, memory; Pratyaksham, direct observation; Aitihyam, the legends; and Anumanam, by inference. These are the four things which are needed. Nothing else is needed. And the astronomy which is given, little bit of astronomy which comes in this text which I will show you, also follows more or less the same system. Even though today this text is recited in religious functions, this text is used for doing Homa and all of that. That is true. It has been preserved. But if you see the meaning, meaning not from my interpretation, but the meaning given in the Sanskrit Vyakhyanas, that is what the tradition themselves they understood was that. But nevertheless, they used it for some other purpose, because they would say Brahman is everywhere, so I would do it here also, there also, everywhere. That is the explanation which is given there. That is the logic which they say. Now, a little bit about Agastya, because I want to attribute a value to this Vedic text. This talks about Agastya as being visible, Agastya as being with the star, and Agastya is a southern star, after all. And initially, there was some conflict in the Vedic period, how to fix up the north-south direction. Like the east-west, the north-south also had to be fixed up. There are large number of legends about the north-south direction. One important thing is Shiva getting married in the Himalayas. All the devas go there. So the weight on that side became more. Shiva asked Agastya to go to the south. And Agastya remained there. Agastya had to remain there. So he balances the north-south. And a similar story comes up even in the Mahabharata about the Nahusha being kicked by the Saptarshis, had to carry him, but there would be an imbalance. The eighth person was Agastya. The Saptarshis are in the north, Agastya is in the south. These eight people had to carry him when he had to go to the Indra Sabha. But Agastya becomes slow, because the movement of Agastya is different, the movement of Saptarshis is different. Saptarshis circumpolar. Agastya is not circumpolar in that way. Agastya rises and sets. So he curses Agastya and he kicks Agastya. Agastya says, "You fall down," tells Nahusha. And that Nahusha is actually originally was this Shishumara. Shishumara is from the Taittiriya Aranyaka. This is a mantra. This mantra is here. Yasmai namastachiro dharmo murdanam brahma uttara hanu, etc. We will not read it. What it says is, there is a animal in the sky, that is a Divya Shakwaraha. That Divya Shakwara, Shakwara is an animal, is called Shishumara. And that Shishumara, one had to worship him or meditate about him, is what the Sayana Vyakhyana writes. That Brahma Upasthana Kale, you have to do the Dhyana on that Shishumara. That is an animal. What are the parts of this animal? You can't imagine an animal without its parts. So it describes, head is Dharma, upper jaw is Brahma, lower jaw is Yajna, heart is Vishnu, genital is the Samvatsara, forelegs are the Ashwin, navel is the Atri, hind legs is Mitra and Varuna, first part is Agni of the tail, second part is Indra, third part is Prajapati, fourteenth of the animal is Abhaya called Dhruva. And the Dhruva is also comes here, and he is said, Namaha Shishu Kumaraya Namaha. He is also a Shishu, he is also a Kumara, and this is the Shishumara figure. And you can immediately see the connection between Abhaya is a fearless, is the fearless child who went to the forest to do the penance and then got a boon and to stay as the pole star. That information is allegorically given here. And if you make a plot of this, and this is from modern astronomy only, this 14 star combination, which looks like an animal, is called Draco in modern astronomy. The Draco has, as per modern astronomy, 16 stars. But these people counted only 14 stars because the 14th was the fixed one. 14th one lies on this polar circle, and that is the Vedic Dhruva. Today it is called Thuban. The modern name is Thuban or Alpha Draconis. That is the name. And a modern astronomy says, due to precession, Alpha Draconis was the pole star around 2800 or 3000 BC. This can be verified, and the planetarium in fact will be much better to verify these things. And the 14 stars, you can see the bright stars I have marked 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. These are the 14 stars which are given. And this indeed looks like a dragon or a Shishumara. Shishumara is a whale or an aquatic animal with a long, it is not a gharial, it would be more like a whale, a four-footed animal. So Taittiriya Aranyaka describes this constellation Draco Shishumara with 14 stars, at the end of which Abhaya Dhruva was stationed. There are several other texts which describes this as a fixed peg driven in the ground around which animals go around. This is the Ekagni Kanda is also a Yajurvedic text that also pictures Dhruva as a peg around which animals can go. This, of course, there are not many models in Siddhantic astronomy, but before Siddhantic astronomy, I think they took this as a model. The model was about the Meru model. We know that we have heard about the Meru, that Earth is connected to the north, the pole star, with a stick or with a column, and that is the Meru. And in fact, in Jain and Buddhistic culture, is very important. Initially, even in the Brahminical, the Vedic culture, Meru is mentioned in the Taittiriya Aranyaka, and also says there is a star which doesn't leave Meru. Kashyapa does not leave Meru. Kashyapa is one of the stars here. Does not leave Meru means it's a circumpolar. That is the meaning given. And the mantras related with Shishumara are used for crossing oceans. That is again mantras. They are all mantras, but that should be said for crossing ocean. What ocean? It may be the real ocean or it may be the samsara sagara. That is where, you know, it is interpreted philosophically, it is interpreted in a sacrificial sense, it is also interpreted in other sense. Now, Nirukta, which belongs, the Yaskas Nirukta belongs to something like 1000 BC, clearly says, for many of the mantras, you can have three kinds of meanings. One is the Adhidaiva meaning, the second is the Adhiyajna meaning, the third is the Adhyatma meaning. Adhyatma is the philosophical thing which has come in the Vedanta and all that. Adhiyajna is what is preserved even to this day. Sayanacharya and others have written the Bhasha for doing the yajnas. The Adhidaiva is related to the astronomical things. What you see in the sky. Daiva originally meant what was seen in the sky. That is Divyate. From that it comes. Sayana himself says, Soma should not be mistaken always for the drink they were drinking. Soma is not simply the herb, Soma is also moon. And we know that Soma is used in the sense of moon. To this day, Somanatha, Somaraja, all that is used in the sense of moon. So if you interpret every Soma in Rigveda and everywhere only in sense of a drink, you don't get at the truth at all. That is going to be misleading. It has been seen in the other sense also. Well, anyway, now this is one figure that I have got from my planetarium software to show in 2830 BC how the Draco was there. And this is the 14th star at the pole, precisely at 90 degree declination, almost. I have given the details here, only about 5 minutes more. Present day, the pole star is about 45 minutes away, but still it looks fixed, 40 or 45 minutes away. Whereas in those times, it was only about 7 minutes away. So this is, if you see the modern way of representing this animal, it looks like this, but you can make a Shishumara also out of it, is a dragon. Now this was known that there is an animal figure in the sky called Shishumara to the Hindus, to the Westerners. That is there in the Allen's book in 1899. The star names is one of the standard books for astronomy. He says, Hindus from whom the Greeks are said to have borrowed, although the reverse of this may be the case, he knew this is a pattern there which looks like animals, but the meaning has changed later on, he keeps on telling that. Well, anyway, I haven't seen in the Greek any name which looks like this so far. I may be wrong, in fact. Now, the question arises, if you are so sure that there was such a star which was known, such a figure which was known, what happened when it drifted? You say that about 2,800 or so. In about 1,000 years, it would have gone away from there. For about 200, 300 years, they might have seen that as the Dhruva and doing all the worship or whatever might have been done. There is a Yajurveda text called the Maitraini Aranyaka. Now the philosophical things all start actually in the Rigvedic period with the Rigveda proper. If you see, the speculations are little. They are not so much about the philosophical things. Whereas in the Maitraini Aranyaka, the beginning itself, the king Brihadratha goes to a rishi by name Shakyayana and asks, Sarvam Chedam Kshayishnu Pashyamaha. Everything is transient in this world. And he is so much worried, he is depressed, he wants to know. He goes to the rishi to ask, what is the meaning of all this? What is his trouble? His trouble is the following. Maharanavanam Shikarinam Prapatanam. The mountains are falling down. The seas are getting dried up. Dhruvasya Prachalanam. Dhruva is moving. And Vatarajunam Nimajanam. The Dhruva is supposed to control all the other planets and all that through Vatarasana. In fact, Siddhantic astronomers also mentioned this. Unseen rays of force or whatever you may call, they are all dipping. They are all dipping. They should have been in some other position, but they have dipped. And this is the question he keeps on asking. Prithivyah sthanad apasaranam. It is as though the earth itself has shifted in some other direction. And to this, of course, he keeps on explaining, we need not go into that. But this would have happened by about 1900 BCE. Dhruva would have separated to about 5 degrees and the circumpolar nature of the star would have been evident in the northern hemisphere. So King Brihadratha feels depressed because even Dhruva was subject to movement around his time, 1600 BCE. How do I come to this conclusion, 1600? That itself is said in the Maitraini Aranyakam. He says the winter solstice starts with Shravishtardha, that is the half of Dhanishta. The beginning of Dhanishta is considered the Vedanga Jyotisha period, about 1300 BC. This would be about 300 to 400 years before, again due to precession. In other words, I don't say that this whole text is a homogeneous text which belongs from page 1 to page. No, it is not like that. There's a culture which questioned these things over centuries and they came to the conclusion something unusual has happened. It is a first order disturbance for any culture that you remember or you believe in something as fixed, like God or like Brahma, and you are totally deceived out of it. And what are they going to do? They have to think newly about time. What is time? And in fact, that is where it comes. Suryo Yonihi Kalasya. These people, after 1500 years or so, start selling, because in the Rigveda it is more about moon. Moon is used, of course, moon can even be used for measuring time. But he says it is sun which matters, and sun is the one which is causing the winter and the summer. There are only two divisions in this, not the six seasons yet, only two divisions. And that started at the half of Dhanishta. And this you can date it to something like 1600 to 1800 BC. So, and this matches with the movement of the pole star. That is what I wanted to climb. And later on, of course, this Meru mountain, I already said, the Jainas and Bauddhas use this, even Mahabharata mentions about it. And Mahabharata and Bhishma Parvan says, Dhruva Prajolito Gauram Apasavyam Pravartate. Dhruva is moving, this is a bad omen during the war. What is meant by Dhruva moving? They knew something had to be fixed, but that star was not in that original position. And there is a very interesting thing in Mahabharata. That is about the marriage of Draupadi. Now, marriage of Draupadi, what it has to do with the pole star? Yeah, it does have. Because they look to pole star and the Shishumara as a very important object in the sky because they have to worship. Vishnu was in the center of that Shishumara. Remember, Dhruva was also there. So, very important thing. The marriage hall was in a place called Shishumarapura. That was not in the capital of Drupada. It was away. Where? Praguttarena Nagarat, Bhumi Bhage, Sameshubhe. It was in the northeastern direction of Drupada's capital, Kampilya or so. And that was called Shishumarapura, and that is where it was done. The Draupadi's marriage and the archery competition of Arjuna, which in fact has an imagery of hitting the pole star, looking and all of that. And this is how it goes on in our ancient text. And this is the Brahmanda Purana. I will quickly cover this. Again, it discusses over about 700 shlokas, not a small one, three chapters, an astronomy which can be called the Dhruva-centric astronomy. They use a model there. And they also use numbers. I haven't understood yet, but we are working on that in our center to see whether any meaning can be made out of this. There is the Dhruva-centric model. And how to understand Dhruva, he says, Shishumaraha Vigneyaha, Autana Padaha, Uttarahanuhu, etc. And I have given all the 14 names which the Taittiriya Arnika gives more or less in the same way, except instead of Dharma, it is here Uttana Pada is the first name. And he is still not this father of Dhruva in Brahmanda Purana. That happens only in the Vishnu Purana. And important thing, Mahendrascha Maricha Kashipo Dhruvaha, what happens to them? Nastam Yanti Chatushtayam. These four do not set. Of the 14 stars, these four stars do not set. They are circumpolar. That, of course, for that period, you can verify they were indeed circumpolar. And they give a model. Now, because Dhruva was fixed and the others were going around, the model, there are two models. One is the Kulala Chakra. Kulala Chakra is this. Dhruva is sitting here. Dhruva, of course, rotates in the same place. But he is, in a sense, fixed. He is not moving out of that, but he is there. And he rotates others also. Rotating force in this case comes from him. That doesn't matter. But once this rotates, due to the momentum, it keeps on rotating. That is one picture he gives. The second picture is Tailapida Chakra. Tailapida Chakra is the Gani. You know, the usual, which is bullock run, machine for making. Even today you can see this. And this is the same way it has. And indirectly he says, the bullocks are like the planets which go around. Dhruva is sitting here and this is the Meru, which connects the earth to the Dhruva. And there is an inclination. That inclination seems to indicate indirectly an obliquity, even though it is not yet clear, we are working on that. Now, as you come further from the Puranic period to the later historical period, so to say, that is around the BCE period. You know that the 500 BCE onwards, the time of Panini, Chanda Shastra, and so many other things, extraordinary scientific development happened during that period, up to the Gupta period or so. In that period, there are many astronomers. Two of the famous names which even Panini mentions, one is about Parashara, the other is Vrithagarga. Parashara, of course, is not available fully, but with some reconstructed text we have done at Jainu University from the quotations of others. And Vrithagarga is available in manuscripts. Now, we are right now working on this manuscript. I'm just showing a little bit of this manuscript. He belongs to something like 300 BC or 500, give and take 200 years, I can't help it. Because exact dating is not possible. Nahi sarvatra ganitam, nahi sarvatra darshanam, darshanam ganitam cheva yugapad yoga sadakam, he says. Everywhere you should not use mathematics. Everywhere you should not, can't have observation. The two you should combine intelligently. For the, why he says, is not any higher mathematics. For moon. Moon cannot be seen in the nakshatras cannot be seen in the morning. Now, nakshatra is defined, the kala, nakshatra, has, they have no independent status. Only with moon they have some status, you know. Because then you know this is this nakshatra on this day, this is the nakshatra on the second day. That was the ancient way of counting. So he says, in the morning, how do you decide where is moon? With which nakshatra? So these are the unequal nakshatra business in this text. So he says, you use your intelligence. First you see, then you use some ganita, that is interpolation, simple interpolation, and you can come to some conclusion. This text also knows two important things in northern hemisphere, the northern sky. This is verse 2400, we are not yet critically edited this. He says, kalam yatnena yojayat, you try to find out the time. Whole of this is only Kala Shastra, Kala Nirnaya Shastra, so to say. Her Siddhantic astronomy or Vedas. So everything is only Kala. Kalam Brahmaiti Upasita, they would finally say. There is no Vishnu, all these are only Kala. Kala is only time. So they were worshippers, what they would call the Saturnarians also. Normal people, how it has to be done? He says to Shishumarasya Vyavritya Tara Matsyasya Dhimata. Either Shishumara you have to look how it rotates or Tara Matsya. This Tara Matsya, I have another 10 minutes I hope, right? Up to 12 I can go? Okay. The Tara Matsya is what Brahma Siddhanta, actually Brahmagupta and others call it as Dhruva Matsya. That is the polar fish, what we see today as Ursa Minor, around 500 BC or the common era, it was going nearer the northern pole, whereas Shishumara had gone far away. There was, this pole star was not known, the original Dhruva. There was a new thing which was going near, that was called Tara Matsya. But that also can be, will be going round and round there only. So they knew that around this period. Now, a new thing happens. We come to the historical period. In the historical period, of course, as I said, Brahmagupta and others called this Dhruvamatsya. It's called the polar fish. This polar fish caused a lot of problems. It's still today it is causing to Indologists particularly, the Western Indologists, not so much to the others. It caused problem to Alberuni. Alberuni, you know, he visited in 11th century. And Alberuni picked up quite a bit of Sanskrit and he moved with the Brahmins to understand what they do and all of that. They shared their knowledge with him. And they all said, he says, the Hindus tell rather ludicrous tales in speaking of the figure in which they represent the group of stars, figure of a four-footed aquatic animal called Shakwara Shishumara. I suppose this latter animal is the lizard. It is called Susmar. It's like the Indian Shishumar. And what is it he is telling? He says their pole is located in this aquatic animal called Shishumara. This is what the Hindus are telling. And what is the reason he gives? And he also says it is the Vishnu Dharma. Maybe Vishnu Purana or some Purana. If you know the shape of this accurately, the 14, your life will be increased by 14 years, is what he said. And he laughs at the Hindus. And he says, but this quotation comes from the Brahmanda Purana. And the Brahmanda Purana wants it to be remembered correctly. There is a reason for that. So if you say that your life will be increased by 14 years, if you look, know the thing correctly, maybe they will know it. That is how it was done. But anyway, he criticizes this, but, and he also talks of the same thing in Yoga Sutra. Many don't know that he translated Yoga Sutra to Persian. And he gave an explanation also. He was a rationalist, had great interest in the Indian sciences. And in the Yoga Sutra, there is a statement, Dhruve Tadgati Jnanam. This has been, of course, in the, if you see the later Sanskrit Vyakyanas, as they want, they have discussed, because they did not know who is Dhruva. And what is meant by Dhruve Tadgati? Where is Dhruva? They did not know. It was the Dhruva's Gati. And he writes that, he knew that in the 10th or 11th century. If you concentrate on the Dhruva, you would know his movement also correctly. That is what he said. Well, anyway, I will not go into that. But the pole itself is Vishnu. the ruler of the inhabitants of the paradise. He is further the time rising, growing, getting old and vanishing. Everything is only that. As a star he is interpreting, but as time is what the texts are going to tell. Now, the Orthodox Hindu informants were only repeating what they knew from the text. The letter of the text may not be the spirit. But did they know the spirit also? Did they come to that? Yes, they did. At least one person came to that. We will see that there are many poetic descriptions of Dhruva. You may wonder, the others who wrote in Sanskrit, did they not look at Dhruva, say something? They did. There is one Mahakavi, Magha. In his Shishupalavada, he refers to this very beautiful shloka, in fact. Sputataram uparishtad alpamurtair dhruvasya spurati suramaninam mandalam vyastametate shakatamiva mahiya shaishave shangapanehe chapala charana kabjehe prerunot uttungitangram. Today being Krishna Jayanti, maybe reading this may not be wrong. You know Krishna's pranks. He kicked the Shakatasura, and that which was a Shakata is a cart, a van, a wagon. So he kicked that and it fell down, and the Shakatasura went away. That is the meaning. Krishna was only a child, maybe 2 months or 3 months. This Mahakavi, when he was living in near Binnamala in Rajasthan, today it is called Jalor. So in the 700-800 CE, if you take a picture of the early morning sky, it looks like this. From that place, this is what I have taken. This is the dragon. This is our Abhaya Dhruva. This is the Dhruva Matsya, which is going towards the pole. But what is the Shakata? Shakata is the Saptarshi. Saptarshi is actually the wagon, the Shakata. It was already, at that time, it was no more circumpolar. And you can see that this Saptarshi is going down the horizon, above the horizon. But when he came out in the early morning, 5 o'clock, it was going down the horizon. So as a poet, he imagined it is this Dhruva, not this Dhruva, it's far away. This Dhruva, this is, even though it's small, so he kicked the Shakata and it's going down. So if you like this kind of astronomy, you will have a lot of this. Now, in this period, very quickly I will finish, there is a conflict which is brewing up, you can imagine. Now, the Vedic things, those people interpret it only with reference to the Vedas. Whereas the others, like the Brahmagupta and others, they were all very rational. They would only observe and say something. They never touched on the Shishumara. They never mentioned about any of this in any of their texts for that matter. Except when you come to 17th century in Varanasi, the Siddhanta Tattva Viveka of Kamalakara. Till that time, I haven't seen anything. Now, there is a text called Vishnu Sahasranama. Many of you would be knowing. The 1000 names of Vishnu is Nakshatra Nemi. Giving a Vyakhyana on the Shankaracharya, who was 800 CE, he says, this refers to the Shishumarasi Hridaya Jyotish Chakrasya Vishnu Riti Nakshatra Nemihi. The Vishnu Hridayamiti Taitirani. He wrote very clearly, his Nakshatra name is only Vishnu, because he is in the center of that Shishumara, and that is said in the Veda. What else you want? Is it Taitirani? He quoted. And his followers also did the same thing in 1700, but by that time there was no Shishumara to look at like aquatic animal. So this person said, it is Shishumara, it's okay, it's Jalajanti Vishesha, fine, but it looks like Sarata Goda Akriti, Sarata Goda Dyakriti. It looks like a lizard. It looks like a garden lizard. It doesn't look anymore like a Shishumara, but it looks like a garden lizard. And that should be, that is where Dhruva is. You have to worship on that star is what he says. Now the other Vedanta schools of Ramanuja and Madhva also accepted the same thing, that the Vedic thing only has to be accepted. Now Sainacharya, the great commentator on the Veda, he lived in the 14th century. And he said the original mantra what I showed in the Taittiriya Aranyaka, to which all these refer. He says, Mantrena udungmukho bhutva dhruvamandalam pashyan shishumara rupena tamu upatishtet dhruvasi vinasha rahitosi. Well, anyway. So, you see, in the evening sandhya when you do, you have to look at the northern sky and you have to worship the dhruvamandala like this in the 14th century what he said. But did you know which was the dhruvamandala? Maybe as a Vedic he knew, because Shankaracharya had said Shishumara, so he knew what was Shishumara. Now, this took a different form also during that period, because there should have been a lot of conflict. This is in the Madhva Sampradaya, I'm sure it's available in Bangalore also. They made to, as the Shankara and others explained how the shape is, they clearly said Shishumara Vishnu is an aquatic animal like this. This you can see, there are four legs. This is Shishumara Vishnu, and the Dhruva is at the tip. And this is worshipped in the temples, you know, particularly in the Madhva Sampradaya temples. So there must have been considerable tension between scientific astronomers and the lay followers. Now, definitely it was there. The scientific astronomers, the polar fish, in fact, the Dhruvamatsya Yantra, Padmanabha created this astrolabe in 15th century to find out time, because he knew that by that time the polar fish had come there, Dhruvamatsya had come, not Shishumara. Shishumara is far away. So the two stars, the alpha and beta of that, they rotate. Even today it happens. He calls it the Dhruvamatsya and the Markati. That is, Kokab is called Markati. The two in the morning and the evening, you see, their face east or west. So by that you know whether it has about 12 hours has gone like that. And he created also other lines to find out the time in between also. This is a very good paper by S.R. Sharma, who has done, is an authority on Indian astronomical instruments and all that, you know. And Bhaskaracharya also talked on this, but he used only Dhruvamatsya. They never mentioned about Shishumara. Well, it is a culture which is still remaining to this day. In the marriage, Dhruva should be seen. Dhruva star should be shown to the bride, and from where this came. This caused a problem for the Western Indologists in dating. And with the Aryan invasion theory and all kinds of nonsensical concepts came at that time because of this. Now, this is the Griha Sutra which is followed. These were Vedic texts towards the end period, around 500 BC. That all, even the Western Indologists agreed, it belongs to about 500 BC. Now, this was used as an argument to fix up the time of, that is the modern astrologer. Okay, before that I want to use this, because the time wise, that is later 19th century, in the 17th century, the Siddhanta Tattva Viveka asked this question, because I'm sure in the 16th, 17th century, because the three kinds of astronomy were meeting, the Indian, the Arab side, and also the Western astronomy was coming into India. There was a lot of commotion happening. And this man was living in Varanasi, and Varanasi was the strong point for all Hindu religious texts and all that, which were written during that period. And the question was, which is the fixed star which should be shown to the bride? I think they had moved, and only the astronomers could answer it. He gives that. Chale chale pi dhruvabe swamesha drashitrayan tad dhruvaka sharastu shashashti bhagaha parinita naryaha mahatpalam darshanatosti yasya. The parinita nari, the lady who is getting married, she should be shown which star. That star is at 66 degree latitude, and the three rashis away, that is 90 degrees. That comes to only the present day Polaris. Thuba is here, the Vedic Dhruva. He said, this is the star which should be shown, implying this is not the Vedic star. That is, you have to take the spirit and not the letter. But anyway, that is another story. Now the Western Indologists used the Griha Sutra. Actually, Jacobi, a German scholar, very interesting German scholar, he said the 500 BC, they knew the Dhruva, the marriage rituals are all based on it, that has not changed afterwards. Now, what Dhruva they would have been seeing? So it should be only the one which was in 3000 BC. He got an astronomer in Vienna to calculate, because there was no planetarium software in those days. They had to do the regular work systematically, and he fixed up and he said it is Thuban, which is the same star which the Egyptians could see, the king lying in his pyramid through the hole that is supposed to be there. Not exactly the Thuban, but one of the stars nearby, because of the errors in alignment, all that. But he came to that conclusion. But that was opposed by others, Whitney, Keith, Winternitz and others. Because if you agree to that, then Rig Veda should go before 1500 BC, the Aryan invasion falls down. Because the Aryan invasion stands in 1500 BC. And the interpretation of chariots and fighters in Rig Veda and horses and all those kinds of things. So they opposed it. They wrote very sarcastic things on this, which in fact, the religion and philosophy of the Veda and Upanishads by Keith is there in the Harvard Oriental series. It is studied in our country even to this day, very unfortunately. There is no religion, there is no such thing at all in any of the Vedic texts as they interpret. It is only about Kala. Well, and this is my last slide. The summary and conclusion. Station of the pole star named Shishumara, which was doubted by Alberuni, was actually a standing tradition, remembered and transmitted in the collective memory of the Hindus. Puranas treat this pole star rather ambiguously. In some places, Dhruva is set fixed. Some places, rationale is evolved out of the circumambulation of this star as the driving force for the circular motion of sun, moon and planets. Jains also use the same model, in fact, in their Jambudvipa Prajnapti and others. But Shishumara was remembered as important. So Dhruva was forgotten, Shishumara was eventually forgotten, but the imaginary Meru was remembered. Always Meru was imaginary line, but that was remembered. I mean, that is the force of an idealism, you see. So Siddhantic astronomers, with their mathematical methods, they did not need support of this, except for the vocabulary Dhruvaka. That they still needed, but not for others. But Mount Meru they also used in their cosmology description, called Bhuvana Pushkara. So Maitraini, Aranyaka, Mahabharata, even Yoga Sutra, Dhruva was not fixed, but was capable of movement. Why did Tadgati, he has to say, Patanjali in his Yoga Sutra? Because it was moving, that is the only reason. Laudation of Shishumara in the Aranyaka is the earliest reference naming a constellations an animal. In fact, there is a big question whether it is the Greeks who named the constellations by animal names, or was there other cultures who were doing it. He is an example of that. And this star was called Abhaya, and was fixed, so it's called Dhruva. In fact, in Sanskrit, it's a peculiar language. The quality becomes the name, the visheshana becomes the nama, you know. More or less, it is the standard. Now, Abhaya is fearless, it's also the name of a person. Dhruva is the quality, is also the name of a person. So that is where the confusion has arisen. So I conclude with this. Two North Pole stars known to the cultural heritage of Indian astronomy. Dhruva, son of Uttanapada and Suniti of the Purana, was originally the Vedic pole star during 3200 to 2800 BC. Thank you very much.
I think you are guided by the size of Ursa Minor when you describe Shishumara, and that is how you fix on, because there is a star called Matsyodhara which is in the constellation of Andromeda today. Therefore, this Shishumara may be a much larger constellation.
That question is perfectly fine, but I am referring to only the evidence which is available, you know. There are 14 stars, the number Chaturdasha is said very specifically. And that Chaturdasha seems to be the reason for many of the new concepts which have come in the Puranas. Like, you know, the Manvantara, like the Yuga. You know that originally Yuga was only 5 years period. But why did long periods come up? And in fact, there are stories in the later Puranas which says, each Manvantara there will be a new Dhruva who will be coming in. And there are only 14 Manvantaras. So I take it as a precision legend. Because this Shishumara with the 14 stars shifted, they thought that there will be new 14 stars slowly coming in. And for each star, there may be one Manvantara they will have to give. Some kind of logic, I don't know. So there might have been other things, I don't deny. But the evidence is for this. You know. Thank you, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.